So Dr. Verma is one of the veterans in the field of healthcare delivery business in India with over 25 years of experience in the domain. So consequently, he has developed an expertise for a broad spectrum of areas, from micro elements of functional process management to macro issues of creating and managing businesses. Dr. Verma has, to his credit, several radical and innovative concepts which has shaped the way healthcare is delivered in our country today. So he's also one of the pioneers in the healthcare profession to have explored the space of venture capital and private equity for hospitals. And currently he manages the countrywide business of Wockhardt Hospitals as its president since 2013. And prior to this, he was the founder CEO of DM Healthcare for 6 years, and also director of operations at Hinduja Hospital and the CEO of at Hinduja Healthcare in Mumbai for 11 years. So with this, I request and I'll call upon Dr. Anupam Verma to please come on the dais. Please.
Thank you so much. I think it was a large sort of an introduction with a lot of big words, and I'm not that big. So thank you so much for giving me the honor of actually delivering the keynote address. The summit on the conference on the hospital planning and infrastructure, I delved upon on it a lot, and two things I'm not for the information of everybody, and which makes me more qualified to speak on the subject. First, I am not a doctor, and second, I am not an engineer or an architect. So this gives me a fresher outlook of the approaching the subject, and that is why I thought that, yes, this will be a good idea of how to, you know, go about it. There are a lot of operational and business aspects of planning, infrastructure, and all the elements which are associated with it. And of course, I have handled a lot of big projects, big planning exercises. Also, I have been fortunate enough to have been given the liberty of irrational thinking, which somebody called radical innovations, into the healthcare space as far as the planning, infrastructure, and the processes are concerned. And with that leverage, actually, I could flex my muscles in a lot of innovations, of course, at their cost. Some failed, some succeeded enormously, and you know, here we are looking at, yes, we can say that in India, the journey of healthcare industry, of which I am a part of for the last 25 years, we have really created a lot of benefits, a lot of innovative ideas, a lot of lot of creativity has gone into it. Also to manage a lot of crisis of the Indian healthcare over a long period of time. I'll just narrate you the incidents of once when I was newly inducted into the healthcare domain way back in 94-95, and that is where you know, I was a part of the new venture planning group of JK Synthetics, which went into the one of the first corporate hospitals, places like Kotar in Rajasthan and all. So when I was first inducted, we were not recognized as an industry. We were there as voluntary institutions. There were hardly any listed entity. The startups were actually gearing up, including Apollos and Wockhardts of this world. And you could go to a bank and get a loan for a cigarette factory, but you can't get a loan for a hospital because it is not recognized as an industry in their books, which was a very, very strange situation. That what is the kind of outlook we have about the hospital industry? Neither were there any people who were expert in the managing of the industry. Probably whole of India had three recognized management graduates, including one of them being me at that point of time. And largely the domain was sort of dominated by the ex-colonels and brigadiers and lieutenant generals and this thing of the army with a very peculiar logic that hospital is about management of a lot of people like soldiers and a large infrastructure like an army cantonment. So that is where, that is how it should be managed. And that is what a lot of discipline is required. And also the stature of the people who are required to manage it has to be, you know, that robdar with mooch. The reason being we are dealing with strange kinds of people, and the strangest kind being doctors. Doctors were larger than life figures at that point of time, more so. Cardiac surgeons were demigods. And the rest of the people were actually subservient to the doctors to a very large extent, like seen in none other industry, probably, that's so. So anyway, how do I? So I am setting the agenda for the day, actually. I am a non-technical person and non-medical person also. Of course, 25 years has given me a voluntary degree of MD in quackery, but that be so. So I will touch upon a lot of subjects which are there and a lot of historical perspectives also. The discourse today, how do I do this? Yeah. So setting the agenda, what we have today, so that is something which is the perspective. And we are here in Nagpur, and I'm so happy to be in Nagpur. I've been operating in Nagpur market for the last 4 years. Thankfully, we have the position of being a market leader here. We have seen almost all the aspects of the healthcare delivery in this place. Wockhardt Hospitals per se has got a huge amount of experience in non-metro towns and areas which have not been touched for a long period of time by the corporates. Of course, there is now a little bit of excitement about the non-metro towns, but this is the agenda which I wanted to touch this thing. So do non-metro possibilities outshine metro realities? And this is with perspective of a hospital. I'm so sorry, I just forgot it. So do this. This is from the perspective of hospital and healthcare delivery. Do non-metro possibilities outshine metro realities now? So we'll delve upon this to a little extent. Largely, these are questions. Can infrastructure innovation be a game changer? Because that is what is the opportunity which the non-metro towns like Nagpur provide. Can non-metro leverage their price advantage? There are a lot of advantages of a Nagpur. Can the fun lies in leveraging those opportunities or leveraging those opportunities? And can a typical hospital monotony, this is a subject which is very near to my heart, can a typical hospital monotony be broken by a non-metro opportunity? And that is where we will be actually looking at a little bit of a case study. I have 30 minutes, I'll keep my time. So this is something which will set the agenda. Going back to the first hospital which I managed, and I made that hospital a 100-bed corporate hospital, which had large plans to actually expand anywhere, which was owned by an industrialist called Mr. Singhania, and his wife being a very prominent developmental pediatrician. We thought we'll go into healthcare and education, which at 94-95, which was a little premature to go into those kind of industries. We said that, okay, we'll come up with a hospital. We engaged a big architect from Delhi, a very renowned architect from Delhi, and we said we'll go in for a hospital and create a very institution which can replicate itself in B-class towns over a period of time. We had a parcel of 4 acres of land, and we created a beautiful hospital. And that hospital, the architect was a sort of what you call a maverick creative architect, and he created modules which were circular in nature and spread over a large amount of land, almost 4 acres of land, only having 100 beds, and large spaces, natural airflows, natural sunshines, sunroofs in almost all consulting rooms. Great thing about that hospital was, and we'll delve it at that point of at some point of time, that every bed had a had a site at the rooftop, which was different in nature, so that the whole idea was the people who are lying down horizontal are always staring at the ceiling, and that is where they can keep on creating imaginary designs on that, and they can actually not get bored, because it was not too much of television at that point of time or too much of entertainment at that point of time. So created a wonderful hospital, natural airflows, even in the midst of the June summers in a place like Kota, you had a temperature running to something around 42, 43 degrees centigrade. Kota being a stone city, it is very hot there. Nice ambience, the perfect architecture was around 40% air conditioning required in the total hospital, so very, very efficient on the energy front. And that is where my induction into the healthcare planning and infrastructure started happening. We raised the hospital, and thankful to the practice of the doctor, we started having a lot of inflow into the hospital from the first day of inauguration. Nobody actually in India knew how to start a hospital, and still it is a teaching subject for me when I go to the institutes for teaching, that when I ask the students that if I make a Sinduja hospital near Hinduja hospital, how does the patient walk in the first day, the first patient on the first day, how does he walk in? And that's a bit of a subject. I mean, nobody knew how to commission a hospital at that point of time. Now there are experts, there are agencies which are doing, but of course at that point of time. So now when we started the hospital, it was fantastic, and I'm actually referring and delving a little more, because what happens is that at that point of time, and pretty still now, and I'll get into the subject at a later stage on that, there was a terrific 9-bed NICU, which was a level 4 NICU at that point of time, 94, because the owner was a developmental pediatrician and a neonatologist. The brother was a famous pediatric neurologist of the country. And we created all the anti-rooms and anti-infection alleys and all this thing to get into the hospital, get into the NICU. So the NICU complex was supposed to be the star hospital, star of that hospital. And the first baby arrived. The first baby was admitted very successfully, and we started all means. We had all the top of the line equipment at that point of time. Puritan Bennett, respirators was something which were unseen in even in Bombay and Delhi hospitals, and we had those, and everything went inside. And then came the requirement of doing an X-ray. And then we said that, yeah, okay, no issues. We have got the best X-ray machines, best mobile X-rays. We tried to push in an X-ray machine into the NICU. Now, considering all the aspects of infection control and an alleyway and anteroom and all those kind of things, it was a square U-shaped entry to the NICU. And believe me, I'll not delve upon it further. We had to shift the patient out to a normal room, and over a period of next 15 to 20 days, brick the whole entrance so that the mobile X-ray can go in. And the similar kind of experience we have actually experienced almost at every place. No hospital facility in this country actually is a smooth operation at the time, because something or the other is left out. Now, why I'm giving this example is that the success and the failure of the hospitals is largely guided by also the infrastructure you have provided for the purposes of healthcare delivery in this country. And more so, in larger institutions, it is much more important to have that. Now, again, going back to the subject where we started, first we'll get into that Why I was telling you this anecdote was to set the agenda of the importance of planning and infrastructure in the hospital domain, or in the healthcare delivery domain. Now, once we have this agenda clear, let us take back a step and let us evaluate what is something which has happened with the metros and non-metros over a period of time. Of course, we have Dr. Gyani here, who has largely seen the evolution of the total healthcare sciences, and he would almost corroborate with me on large amount of points which I make here. And just to give you a historical perspective and the importance, we'll get into that. So let's take a step back and see why metros have ruled the healthcare. Until now, at this point of time also, we regularly hear, having a facility in Nagpur, that X percentage of patients have gone to Bombay, and X percent patients have gone to Hyderabad or Bangalore or Delhi, for that matter. Why? And it was largely a mindset. And once we researched, I was doing a very big study with a famous consulting firm called A.T. Kani while I was at Hinduja. And that industry, that sort of study was named as, very beautifully named as, democratization of Indian healthcare. And the whole idea was to invest an amount of approximately 2,500 or 3,000 crore of rupees in democratization of Indian healthcare, and that is why we did this thing. To your surprise, the major cause for people not, or the doctors who were eminent doctors, not coming and settling in B-class towns for children's education. They always thought that the Jamnabais and Nasimonjis and Bombay Scottishes of Bombay or DPS of Delhi is a better option for their children. They were not really worried about the medical facilities, which they thought the requirement will come very later in their life. Children's education was the main reason for the bigger doctors not settling in the non-metro towns. Of course, the infrastructure, the availability of infrastructure was not there, as I would come into explaining. So the infrastructure was very, very, I can say, pathetic 10 years back or 15 years back into the B-class towns, with hardly any names or any sort of quality conscious or even status conscious organization to have an infrastructure here. Largely, and 80% I can say with surety, but without any data, were the hospitals which are owned by erstwhile general practitioners. And the qualification of the general practitioners was their ability to garner a huge amount of patients for a hospital, irrespective of the doctors and the specialties present. So this was the scenario for the doctors not coming there. Then connectivity, a lot of doctors, there was a reverse brain drain. A lot of doctors wanted to settle in the country, and they always thought that the gateway of India is either in Bombay or at the maximum Chennai or Delhi. Even Bangalore and Hyderabad were not a preferred location. They have only come in last 15 years or so. Spectrum of technology available, would you sort of equipment maintenance availability, which was there at my point of time when I was operating at Kota. The latest gadgets, the only heart-saving equipment, which was only life-saving equipment, which was available at that point of time, was a defibrillator, and that was a big acquisition for these things. Puritan Bennett ventilator was something which 99% of the doctors, they didn't know how to operate it, and I was actually amazed when people had to go back to their course books to learn what CPAP is. So that was the era when almost nothing available there, largely because the GE Philips and Siemens, which were the bigwigs of the Indian healthcare domain in the equipment front, did not have a servicing network to service anything except these four or five places. And that was a very difficult period. Means if the CTs were not extant, if the smallest of equipment was down, it would take 3 days for the service engineer to come in, another 3 days to contact his head office for the spare parts, and almost you had a 15 to 20 day shutdown of that particular equipment. What will happen if the patient was on it or it was required urgently? We didn't have any sort of scope. So that was an absolute sort of inconvenience for the doctor's perception to actually go and sit down there. Of course, what mattered was that there was a huge inequity in the population as far as the income levels were concerned. So affordability of the metro people, of course. Now I can say that the purchasing power parity of B-class towns is much better than metros, where most of the thing is eaten by the rentals or the cost of real estate in metros, and more than that is eaten by the excise duty on the petroleum products of the Government of India. So on the petrols and all. So that is something which is a reality now. And of course, traditionally, this was something which was a trend which was going on, and most of the people thought that it will go on. And this was the scenario till probably 2004, 2005, 2003. I understand that Government of India, through a regulation in company affairs, declared healthcare as an industry. And actually, you could go to the bank in 2002, 2003 to get a loan for the these things. Patients flocked metros. That is the perception of higher skill set. The big doctors were there. And the trust factor. That's what they call ghar ki murgi, you know, dal barabar. Sort of scenario was that, no, I don't trust. The patient is serious, I need to go to Bombay. The patient serious, even though it meant a 14-hour long journey to city of Bombay, and actually having all the hassles of getting admitted in any hospital of the Bombay, because Bombay was supposed to have no beds at that point of time. Most of us have actually seen that era where getting an admission into a hospital was much more difficult than getting a admission in a Delhi DPS. So that was something which was the reality at that point of time. The spectrum of technology available, people thought, yes, there are minimally invasive technologies available, so why should I get an operation? Let me go to Bombay for an operation. The replacement surgeries were in Bombay, the transplants were in Bombay. Of course, that was only kidney transplant at that point of time. And of course, there is an aspirational factor. The people from Jabalpur will always come to Nagpur, the people from Nagpur will always go to Bombay, and the people from Bombay will always go to US. Recently, one of our ministers had an open heart surgery in the US. I don't know what was the requirement. I'm not being critical of the government, but this is something which shows that we do not really have a faith in the Indian medical industry by the top echelons of the country. Anyways, and of course, a perception of clinical excellence, which was largely true to some extent, that yes, the consciousness of quality and the consciousness of healthcare delivery was much more in the metro towns than the smaller places. Where I, again, means I'll go to a pre-95 era where I was living in a very small place in Rajasthan, consequent to my employment, JK Synthetics. And I have seen the largest nursing home called Mahavir Nursing Home at that place, which was having a capacity of 30, 40 beds. I could see from my window that lot of people used to flock there from villages, and it was in a small town, and they were coming, you know, irrespective of caste, creed, religion, affordability, and most of the people were from villages. So what would the only doctor per se, or you can call the only doctor who was a general physician, what would he do? First of all, to catch the patient for any ailment whatsoever, before even the doctor would see, one of the assistant nurse would put in an IV. And a 50 bed has got limitations. And what would that do? Now you would see that on the parapet outside the hospital, I could see from my window, the guy is holding the IV and sitting like this. And the IV is going on. The second thing which was done was, immediately before the doctor sees, take the blood. Send it for testing. And what happens is then somebody keeps on noting that now what is coming there, the IV is holding on that guy, he cannot run away, the blood has been taken, and then now the doctor sees it. And 2 out of 100 of the patients would make a halla. And believe me, I'm not joking, neither I'm in a mood to sort of make you laugh. There were people there at that point of time, if they made noise to go home, and ultimately the doctor had to relieve. So what they would do is take out the IV, shake the bottle, and ask them to drink the bottle because that was required. So people were drinking normal saline there. Dr. Gyani, we have seen those kind of days, and I don't know how much it is prevalent in the rural India right now. I think their consciousness has gone much higher. But those were the days which were, there in the B-class towns. So the point which I'm going to, which I'm trying to make is something which, that was the requirement where the metro-centric attitude of the healthcare delivery was very, very prominent. Thirdly, the third, which is which was very important, the investments only came there. Investments came for funny reasons there. The big money, of course, comes to big places because all the merchant bankers live there, because all the banks' headquarters are there. It was always a very concentrated population in those cities, and the drainage was perceived to be very large. The technology was easy to deploy. It was easy to manage the hospitals. Big doctors were available there and largely on a visiting basis as well. So ease of entry into the space was very easy. The willingness of overseas doctors to come to metros was very high. So always the investors thought that, yes, this is the place we need to do it. Civic infrastructure, power, water, metros were not really subjected, except for probably Delhi to some extent, for large power cuts and for large water problems. The promoters always lived in the metros. And always one of the major things, if you see the honor of the hospital in the country, wherever the promoter lives, apart from the business sense which a hospital or their flagship institution makes, more sense is about the social power which is derived by the promoter to be in that place of hospital domain, where he is seen as a messiah in the society because he owns a hospital. And that is true probably with most of the Bombay hospitals, with a large amount of Delhi hospitals, may not be now, but yes, at some point of time, but that was true. So largely their investments were only directed towards either their the large institutions in the metros, or if required, the village, a small facility in the village in which they were born. So these were the two places largely covered. So this literally did not have an investment attractiveness, these small places, in that point of time. Now, what is the scenario? And this creates an opportunity for the smaller places. Each one of these attributes have been diluted over a period of time with the advancements of the GDPs, with the advancements of society, with the sort of healthcare investments coming in. So they're either diluted, and I won't go back to enumerate how they have been diluted, but yes, they have been diluted or challenged, or they have lost relevance over a period of time. And this is the opportunity which has been in place for the last probably 5, 7, 10 years since I have seen the amount of money which is flowing in the private equity into the hospitals have actually injected adrenaline into the whole system. Now, a decade ago, as I said, there were no big players, lack of major investments. Hygiene of infrastructure is one other thing which was very, very sad in the non-metro towns. You won't find, and I'm delving on a very micro issue here, one of the major deterrents for the moneyed people or the affording people in the smaller places was the hygiene of the place which were in the non-metro towns. Of course, this has been corrected to a very large extent, and always it was a general practitioner's hospital. Even I have seen even the places which are bigger ones right now have been previously owned by general practitioner. I don't know, but probably they were the money minting machines of healthcare industry in the B-class towns or in the non-metro towns earlier. And outdated technology, non-transparent commerce, as I said, means people would take the cues from the compounder who was sitting outside into which kind of vehicle the patient has arrived so that they can make the bill accordingly. So that was the kind of sort of practice which was there. And of course, clinical outcomes, not something which was not documented. A large amount of huge mammoth work has been done by Dr. Gyani in actually bringing in a lot of quality parameters in the domain, and a lot of things have gone a little more streamlined in those places also because of the awareness of the consumer. But yes, in the B-class towns, there was no recording or there was no element of the clinical outcome which was there. One very strange thing was also there, which is a large amount of emotional thing, which has a lot of corrected. The value of life in the non-metro towns was minuscule compared to the metro towns. So if you run an ICU in a remote place, the possibility is 90% that the people will run away leaving their child, because the concept which goes on there, especially in India, is it's cheaper to produce another child than to treat this one. And these were the elements which were, you know, a decade ago, which was there. And a lot of people, means the death or the mortality and any kind of morbidity was taken very, very lightly in rural India at a point of time. It decided, say, okay, ye to hota hai sort of scenario. So the thrust on keeping a person alive and keeping a person fit was something which was very, very minuscule. So this is, I thought, which is one of the reasons of that. And what is the non-metro opportunity now? This is a great opportunity which has come in, wherein it has largely been derived out of the economic upturn the India has taken over the last 20 years or so, where the affordabilities have increased, the connectivities have increased, and the inclination of quality of qualified doctors has become very high in getting into the tier two towns, because of very huge amount of competition which is there in the class in the metro towns. And metro towns have largely saturated as far as the infrastructural thing is concerned. Even if you see that if you're in any metros, whether it is Delhi, and I would call Gurugram a new metro right now, and probably Chennai, or if they have to only treat the patients belonging to Chennai or Delhi or Bombay, I think half of the institutions will close down still. Because there is a kind of an oversupply in these places with integrated with the spaces, which are largely, there's not too much of disease which happens because of the quality of life in metros. Of course, the contrary view is that yes, they are more the people in those places are more conscious of their healthcare, so the availing of the healthcare services into large institutions is pretty more prominent there. But no, I still feel, having worked in Bombay, that if the Gujarat, the rest of Maharashtra, and a little bit of MP stop supporting Bombay, I think two or three hospitals would have to turn themselves into hotels. That is a more bigger requirement in Bombay. So the spread of technology which was available, the equipment manufacturers took this opportunity and spread their wings far and wide, and the saturation of metros. Then came the realization there are 400 odd towns in India which have got a catchment of more than 10 lakhs of people. And 10 lakhs of people is a big, big, big facility, even for a big, big, big catchment for even a 400 to 500 bed hospital. But the metro, still people went cautious and went into a model of around 150 to 200 bed hospital, and that is where they succeeded to a very large extent. And of course, there was a proliferation of a large amount of government schemes and the insurance sort of consciousness. The health insurance tax benefit was one of the major impetuses into the funding of the healthcare to whatever extent. And once that came in late 20s, that is something which was taken largely by the non-metro population for the purposes of tax saving. It was never meant for actually availing the hospital facilities. But yes, that created a fillip for the nearby sort of hospitals or nearby medical institutions which have the facility of my cashless transaction. People found it very easy. Of course, the proliferation is not more than 20 to 30% in that domain. And now they're rising in terms of scaling to high-end infrastructure. Of course, there are a lot of institutions which are coming up. There are a lot of cost-saving initiatives, and largely the two kinds of costs can be saved. I think it's a myth that construction cost can be saved, but there is a huge amount of delta difference in the land availability, in the land cost, in the non-metro townships. Also, the large parcels available actually give you an opportunity of very, very finely integrated, end-to-end integrated facilities there. That's an opportunity which is only presented by the non-metros here, and which definitely reduces a lot of cost and actually creates a lot of quality parameters which get inbuilt by the even integration of those diagnostics and curative facilities. Comfort, care, hygiene, and then came the entry of super specialists there and the capability to treat volumes in the non-metro. Now the situation is absolutely reverse. The single institutions or the smaller institutions or better institutions of non-metro townships, they churn out bigger volumes than any of the metro towns. The kind of cardiac procedures we do in Nagpur probably is not matched by anybody, any single entity in Bombay. The numbers, and I'm talking of volumes. There might be a delta difference in the price factors of these things. So what is X costing in Nagpur may be costing 3X or 3.5X, ranging from 2X to 4X in Bombay, but the volumes are not there. The best possible interventional cardiologist, if somebody is doing 30 plasties in Bombay, a little unheard of. But it's probably norm with almost 5 or 7 cardiologists in Nagpur. So that is something, the capability to churn volumes is something which came to the forefront and came to the benefit of the non-metro townships. Multidisciplinary facilities, of course, the single speciality scene was a little pushed out. And then came the web. In the last 5-7 years, physical and web connectivity is something which, physical of course, yes, with the airports and all those infrastructure, but yes, web connectivity has acted a very large amount of these things. In smaller places, the patients walking through the web door have become very high. Sujata, my center head here, would be doing almost 5-7% of her business through the web entrance. Web entrance means people scouting for healthcare facilities on the web and then actually getting on to you. In Rajkot, it is much more higher. In Nasik, it is the highest. So these are the places where this thing, yes, I'm absolutely aware. Yeah. So I thought I'll fall short of 30 minutes, so, but yeah, fair enough. So I'll just take 5 more minutes. Yeah. So here is a quote which, and I wanted to actually get into the main objective of innovations, etc., which of course, to a very brief extent, I'll touch upon. Somebody on the Orient Express gets here, there was a murder on Orient Express, that was a great novel. And the question is, who killed him? The answer is, everybody in the train killed him. And the answer about who killed the healthcare is the status quo. But the only sad part of it is, right now, if you see, and this is something which is my thesis and which I keep telling my people, every other industry has seen a huge amount of innovation. Has anybody in this room seen any innovation on the product front of healthcare? We are doing the same things in the same manner, which is done in the same way anywhere in the world, and we'll continue to do the same things. The process innovations are almost not there. The infrastructure innovations are almost not there. The product product innovations are not even heard of. So that is something which is, to set the theme that yes, there is a huge opportunity which is being presented by the smaller towns, and that is where the opportunity also is to innovate as per the requirement of the whole place. But as per the requirement doesn't mean that. I'm just reminded of one fact. From the age of the bullock carts, if people were to increase the efficiency of the bullock carts, so from 2 kilometers an hour, they would have, now we would have gone into 20 kilometers an hour by injecting an amount of adrenaline into the bulls and all this kind of things. But the idea is not that. The motor car would never have been invented. So what we need to have is a lot of innovation rather than taking a lot of feedback, understanding the requirement of this thing, and modulating our systems and practices marginally. Okay. So, of course, I'll not get into a lot of this right now. We don't have to emulate metros. We have to innovate. We have to create differentiation. And there are a huge amount of opportunities. Of course, my presentation would be available for people. We can actually, you can take a copy for if you want, if you're interested in this thing. So a lot of innovative possibilities are there, and we need to create a differentiation into the market. And we have the opportunity to innovate because that is where the growth comes from. The growth doesn't come from the status quo. The growth comes from the innovation in the process, in the infrastructure. And I'm just taking 5 more minutes with your permission, which I have assumed. Okay, and just I wanted to actually create a case study, and which is the basic agenda of this conference, was a case study on the Aster MedCity, which I had the opportunity to make in Cochin. And that is where this was the land when we saw it. This was the land when I first went there, and a man was walking in front of me with a snake stick so that he can take off the snakes off my way to actually go in. So I bought 41 acres of land from 110 owners very discreetly, and this is something which was there. And after that, we went into an exercise, and I'm just delving on the importance of planning. This was something which was created by me and my team for the purposes of creating an organization or an institution which was unique in the country, which actually is a big hospital, but for the purposes of positioning, has a plethora of centers of excellence which are uniquely identified even from outside. And it was a challenge to how to make those centers of excellence on the front and how to actually at the back end integrate for operational efficiencies for the purposes of switchability of the facilities and all those things. So this is something which we created. This is a very simple, these things. So it is what happens where, how the centers of excellence function and how the stream of diagnostics and facilities is running throughout the unit. Apart from this, we went into a huge exercise of doing thorough process flow. And even to the extent, because it is 10 lakh square feet, we calculated. So there would be something like 500 of these sheets where each and every patient's process flow was mapped for all the centers of excellence, all the diseases, all the possible conditions, wherever patient landed. So there would be something like 100-150 of these sheets, and then this is only for the emergency part of the process flow. So everything, what happens when even a person comes with a bone problem or a person comes with a multi-organ failure, everything of this thing. We even calculated the times and distances which each of these diseases would have in that large facility to get into the operational mode. So this was a huge amount of work. We were held by a Canadian healthcare programmer and a great programmer from the HKS in US, and we created this whole document, and this whole thing was, the whole Aster MedCity was created, and this is what it is now. So if you see those Z things there, the most optimal designing aspect was circular designing, which we thought will not work because it had to go high up vertical in the air. And then we said that I think a snake with a spine design is something which will work, where each of the sides have got an opening for the centers of excellence, and this is what resulted. So a lot of, so the whole idea is to set the tone of the conference is this. There is a way to do it better. Please find it. I have no solutions. You create your own solutions. They are risky, but they're worth it. Thank you so much.